Blaine Fowler. Blaine, welcome back to the set, to the Big Easy. You're home away from home, right?
Yeah. For at least two games a day for the last how many days? Right here. No, I sit right there, though. No, I sit there.
Yeah, you sit here. You sit here.
Jerem sits there.
And I sat here with you.
And Spencer sits down there, I'm down there.
What do we call down there? Good. This is the big. Is that the bayou down
the
there?
It's the swamp.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just got to roll your sleeves up and get into the swamp.
You
got
to go to work.
Game.
Go down there.
Just call the game.
Like
baby.
Fast and the Furious 7, The Rock. Daddy's got to go to work.
Got to go to work.
Cast.
It works better if he says it with his biceps.
I'm getting soft this week. I've been sitting around eating all week long and just calling games. My voice is getting messed up. I haven't lifted in a week. It's bad.
Neither have I, man. That's crazy.
I'm ready to get back in the gym.
I consume more chips and soda this week than any other week all year. Was that the case for you guys?
Yes.
Because we're in this arena every day all day.
To keep alive. Now, I did limit it to baked chips. That's way healthier.
Okay. Now we're talking.
I can applaud
way
that.
Healthier.
Yeah, yeah, I can applaud
an
that.
An early rise and shout for the baked chips.
They had the baked.
Okay, let's ask you the Twitter question. We'll start there with the official questions. What is the biggest story for you right now within BYU sports? There's a lot going on. Football, spring practice, men's and women's basketball and postseason play, baseball after their best start, volleyball ranked number two. What do you think?
Well, now that the tournament's done, spring football. That's it. It is. I think when I walking around town in Utah, wherever I am, the thing that people come up and ask me about most often is, what are you hearing from spring ball? What's going on? How's Taysom doing? I hear he's ahead of schedule. What about Jamal Williams back? That's the topic of conversation. So for BYU fans, I think that's the biggest deal. And there's a lot of great things going on. I mean, I love Mike Littlewood, and I love that baseball team and what they're doing. You guys are telling me that's a better start than when Wally and Corey and Scott, all those guys were
Isn't
there?
Isn't that
Rick
unbelievable?
Aguilera, yep, all those guys.
Wow. That is impressive. He's a fantastic coach. I miss him during this time of year because when I'm doing a ton of games around the West, people don't know what a good basketball official Mike was. One of the top in the country. But BYU fans never saw him because he couldn't do BYU games because that's his alma mater.
He's done a couple of Elite Eights.
He's. I would see him all the time. The big, big Mountain West games that I would do, whether San Diego State, UNLV, you name the big game, he was on that. He was right there with David Hall and Vern Harrison, those guys, and a fantastic official. And so the only loss for him coming to be the head coach of BYU in baseball is that we miss him in college basketball officiating. He was really, really good. He knows the game. Do you guys ever have him break down basketball when he comes on?
We've talked about officiating, not basketball analysis per se. We have you do that, but yeah.
He knows the game. He's great. He's doing a fantastic. So, hey, and the teams are going to postseason play. The women are in the NCAA tournament for certain. They're probably a sixth seed, and the men are going to be in the NIT most likely, and they've got a chance to make some noise in that tournament. Those are all big things, but what do people ask me about? They don't walk up and ask me about that. They walk up and they ask me about spring football every time.
Ty Detmer, Taysom Hill, Tanner Mangum, Jamal Williams.
There's so many questions because it's so new and it's so exciting for everybody.
It's not very compelling or exciting right now. There's nothing really new going on with football. There's so much going on, right? It seems to be somewhat uneventful at a spring ball, which I think is an okay thing. I think those guys are going to work, putting their nose to the ground, establishing new systems. It's nothing crazy or outlandish is happening in spring football right now.
Yeah, the coaches only know, they don't even know half the kids.
What's your name?
They put names up the first day that the coaches all got together to see who was who, and literally half the kids, nobody knew them. And these are guys that don't play. Some of these guys don't play. And so the first part of this is to get to know the kids a little bit and what their skill sets are. The fun part is everybody's got a blank slate so they can compete for jobs.
Including one Gavin Fowler.
That's right. Gavin's back from his knee surgery, and so he'll be working his way up the depth chart as he gets healthy again. He's only 8 months out, so he won't be full speed for a little while yet, but he's out there competing full speed, but he won't be as fast as he was before the injury until usually it's about 12 months coming back from that. If you talk to Kyle Collinsworth or to Brian Keel and those guys, they'd say 12 months you'll be feeling like you got your regular old knee back. So he's a couple months away, but he'll be ready for fall. Be ready for fall.
What's the best thing you have heard coming out of spring football thus far in terms of performance or ideologies, whatever?
I love what I'm hearing from both the coaches and players about what they're focusing on. On both sides of the ball, offensively and defensively, they really simplified things. They're going to put a premium on having the players be able to play at full speed. And Broncos had a lot of success with their concepts, But Broncos defense especially requires a ton of reads, even after the snap of the football. So if this, then that. So we're going to line up, and this is what you're going to do. But if this guy goes this way and that guy goes that way, then you've got on top. So you're reading and you're making decisions while you're playing. And so it puts a premium on having veteran players. And then once you get it, the reads put you in great positions. But if you make a mistake, you get exposed. This defense is much simpler. And they get a pre-snap read. For the most part, they lock into what their assignment is, and then they just play. And I believe they're a week into it, and almost the entire defense is installed already. So it's that simple.
Wow.
And now it's about, okay, guys, now work on technique. Make sure you master what we're doing. Get playing at full speed. They want these guys to take advantage of their athleticism and play at full speed and feel like they'll be better. That's this defense that Ed Lamb and Tuiaki and these guys are putting together is one that they're going to really rely on these guys playing free and confident and not making a lot of mental mistakes. On the offensive side, they're simplifying schemes as well. There was a lot of reads on the offensive line in previous years. This year, they'll have assignments. They'll know what those assignments are. So before the snap, they know who they're going to get, and those can change with communication. But the quarterback's going to know he's going to make a call at the line of scrimmage like we used to do in the old days of the direction that he wants the blocking to go. So he knows who the free player is, and if he comes, he's responsible for getting the ball out. So I think simple concepts are going to allow this team to play faster and not make as many mistakes.
Which is interesting because Ty has talked about, okay, we want to slow it down a little bit.
They're going to huddle.
Yeah, we want to huddle, and that's such a crazy idea. Oh, my goodness. Okay, we've been here. We watched BYU lose to Gonzaga a couple nights ago, and Gonzaga is the king of this tournament. They own this place. I joked that they own the court. They actually own the court.
They certainly own this hotel when I walk around.
Yes, they do. Everyone from Spokane is here. I don't know who's there. Roxy Bernstein said something like, I don't know who's in Spokane.
There's nobody left.
He said it's a good time to rob a bank in Spokane right now.
He said he didn't. He didn't want to endorse that. But what's the biggest difference right now between the programs, BYU and Gonzaga, in your opinion?
Right now, Gonzaga in this environment has a mental edge. They've done this so many times that they come in and they expect to win. And it's not just their own mental edge. So in their minds, the other teams in the league expect them to win when they come into this tournament. And so that along with they're always really good, they're always really talented, their bigs are really good. Sabonis is an NBA player, could go out this year and he'd get drafted.
Yeah, he's this year, man.
He's a couple years away from being a solid NBA player, but here's the risk. If he came out this year and you didn't draft him, you'd be taking the risk that 2 years from now you wouldn't even have a chance to get him. So somebody would take him right now if he went out. They absolutely would because of his skill set. Their guards are solid. Wiltshire makes really, really good decisions. He's a pure shooter out there. He's a tough matchup because of his length. So they have some really good pieces. And Dranginis played, I thought, particularly well in the BYU game defensively. How about the fact that in the end of the parts of that game in Provo between BYU and Gonzaga, and then for most of the game here, they put Sabonis on Kyle Collinsworth.
What a move defensively. I thought
brilliant.
That limited Kyle.
It's brilliant. And they were good with the rotation, so when Kyle took him and tried to go by him, they helped out, so they were good. They were very sound with what they decided to do, had a good game plan coming in, and that limited what Kyle could do. And so what that did, that put a premium on the wings being able to make shots. And so that it really took away Kyle's ability to drive and do all those things where he can just change a game. So they said, okay, BYU's wings, you have to beat us. And they just didn't have – they were close, but they didn't have quite enough to beat them last night. They had to make
from Chase Fisher.
They needed a higher percentage of shots made from Chase Fisher. And you know what? Nick Emery played out of his mind, but he had some bad shot selections down the stretch too, where they could have been a little more patient. Because when he gets a good shot and he's squared up, oh, he makes it. Like, he's very consistent shooting when he takes good shots. And so I thought they had a great game plan, and I don't know that there's a lot BYU could have done to combat it other than knockdown shots.
For all intents and purposes, it appears that BYU men's basketball is now certainly headed for the NIT. I know the future looks amazing, the next 5 to 7 years with recruits coming in, and people are super excited, and I think they should be. And I know that Dave Rose is really high on that, but now it's the NIT. Mm-hmm. What kind of a team do you expect to show up in the NIT from BYU?
Whether you're playing the NIT or the NCAA, it's like this whole new thing. So you're just kind of like, okay, let's shut that bad loss against Gonzaga out and let's start over again, see if we can't make a run here. And momentum builds in the NIT. You don't know where you're going to play next. Are you going to be home? Are you going to go on the road? But to get back to New York and play is a cool reward at the end of that. BYU's been back to the Final Four. And so there's some point of reference there of how fun that can be. And these guys don't want to stop playing. They're a dangerous team. Mark Few last was it last night or the night before, whenever that game was, I can't remember. Mark Few from the up at the podium said, hey, BYU is a really good team this year. We're a really good team this year, and we're both playing pretty well right now. He said, if BYU's in the NCAA tournament and I was a one or two seed and I had to play them, I would be very nervous about playing BYU. They're dangerous because when they shoot the ball well, and if they can get hot and on a roll for a couple weeks, they got a chance to advance in that thing pretty far.
When you look at the women's team, if they're a six seed or a seven or a five or whatever, and we'll talk to Charlie Cream, a bracketologist coming up from ESPN, how far do you think BYU can go, the women?
They have a chance, and we mentioned just at the beginning, they're probably a six seed. We thought maybe they could move up to a five with a win, but they're probably not going to drop. Their RPI is high enough that they should hold there.
Yeah, 15 in the RPI.
Yeah, so they're not going
to
go lower than
actually.
Six. As a six seed, this is certainly a team that has the talent to be in the Sweet 16 and then maybe beyond that. Mm. So they've been to the Sweet 16 a couple of times with Jeff Judkins. It's a team that can get out and run, so they can play at pace, or they can play in the half court. They did not take care of the basketball in the San Francisco game the way they need to in the tournament. That was their Achilles heel in this one. They had some tough calls go against them at the end of the game against San Francisco, and they got a little bit on their heels. But then they came down, they were careless with the ball. They still were in control of that basketball game if they take care of it. They had some turnovers. Turnovers cost them in that ball game. And this is against a team in San Francisco that's really active, but turns the ball over themselves during the regular season. And they almost doubled their turnovers, and then they were big-time plus in turnover margin. San Francisco was in that game. And that's what really cost in the end, carelessness with the basketball is what cost BYU. And Lexi didn't shoot it great, but she's not always – here's the nice part about BYU, the women's side. Lexi can have an off night, and they have plenty of other scorers that can pick it up. Kalani can have an off night. You know, you can't have them both off on the same night, but they have the luxury to have one of the bigs, you know, the big scorers off and still win a tournament game. That they've got a lot of talent and they're pretty balanced. Even though Lexi dominates in scoring, there's other folks that can step up.
BYU women's basketball now awaiting their seeding on Selection Monday. Selection Sunday won't include BYU in terms of the big dance, the NCAA tournament, but the national invitation tournament, BYU will find out who
which
and where
BYU
they are
has
playing.
Won twice, Spencer.
That's
51
right.
51 and 66.
Yes.
There's a rich tradition.
That is right.
In that tournament.
And they went to the Final Four in 2013.
Yeah, I remember that. It was a fun run for them to get
we
back to Madison Square
Garden. We sent Steve Cleveland live from Madison Square Garden, baby. We
that's
did
right.
a pretty
I remember
job.
That
was fun.
It's an interesting thing because listening to Mark Few last night, the league this year, the WCC, is undervalued. Like, he felt like Gonzaga, BYU, and St. Mary's were all good enough to be in that field of 64. But it was in the preseason when the league didn't do well. It's when BYU was trying to figure out who they were without Tyler Haws. It's when Gonzaga was suffering through some injuries and trying to figure it out. So the RPI for this league was set early on. Now at the end of the year, I do think Gonzaga, BYU, and St. Mary's are all good enough, better than half the teams in that tournament field and should be in that field. But to get into the field, that's a body of work for the whole season. And this league took time to find itself at the beginning, and so the league's RPI was just too low to give them the mojo to get into this thing.
Yeah.
Blaine, great stuff as always, man. I'm sure we'll see you soon down the road. Dual threat analyst, football, basketball.
Go lift, bro.
For BYU TV.
I'm going to go lift.
Go get that lifting in, man.
I'm going to lift furniture. We're moving to Provo.
And no more big.
We're moving to Provo.
Baby.
No more big chips.
Yes.
I'm going to be hanging out with you guys in the building all the time because I'm moving to Provo. This weekend.
Go. You're finally.
Finally.
Welcome.
I'm sorry, I'm busy.
Land.
I can't help this weekend.
That was my next question. Who's available?
Yeah. Talk to the elders.
I am Blaine. I'm available.
Don't worry. Two men in a truck will help me out.
Okay. You have Gavin, too. Your son plays football for BYU. He can help lift a few things.
Get Mo Longy off his mission or something to help you.